Hey Linux enthusiasts, welcome back to Ton Does Linux and More. I'm Ton, and if you've been following the Linux world this week, you know it's been absolutely wild. We've got critical security vulnerabilities that you need to patch right now, some incredible kernel updates, major distribution releases, and honestly, some of the biggest changes to Linux gaming we've seen all year. Let's dive into what has been one of the most eventful weeks in Linux land. And hey, if this video helps you stay secure and up to date, smash that like button and subscribe for more Linux content every week. Alright folks, we need to start with the elephant in the room, and this is serious. Two critical vulnerabilities have been discovered in Sudo, and I mean critical, with a capital C. If you're running any major Linux distribution, you need to pay attention to this. We're talking about CVE-2025-32462 and CVE-2025-32463. Now the first one might not sound too scary, with a CVSS score of 2.8. But here's the kicker. This vulnerability has been hiding in plain sight for over 12 years. That's right, since September 2013, there's been a flaw in Sudo's host option that could allow users to execute commands they shouldn't be able to. But the real nightmare is CVE-2025-32463, with a CVSS score of 9.3. This one is absolutely devastating. It affects Sudo's trut option. And here's what makes it so dangerous. Any unprivileged user on a system with a vulnerable Sudo version can potentially escalate to root privileges. You don't even need any special Sudo rules configured. The default configuration is vulnerable. The vulnerability works by tricking Sudo into loading an arbitrary shared library. An attacker can create a malicious etctnsswitch.conf file in a user-controlled directory and potentially execute commands with root privileges. This is the kind of vulnerability that keeps system administrators awake at night. The good news? It's been patched in Sudo version 1.9.17p1. The bad news? This affects virtually every major Linux distribution. Ubuntu, Red Hat, SUSE, Debian, Alma Linux, Alpine, Alma Linux, Gentoo, Oracle Linux, you name it. If you're running Linux, you're probably affected. So here's what you need to do right now. Pause this video if you need to and update your systems. On Ubuntu or Debian, run sudo apt update and sudo apt upgrade. On Red Hat-based systems, use sudo dnf update or sudo yum update. On Arch, run sudo pacman syu. Don't wait on this one, folks. The sudo project maintainer, Todd Miller, has even announced that the trut option will be completely removed in a future release because supporting user-specified root directories is just too error-prone. Now let's talk about what's happening in kernel land, because we've got some significant developments this week. Linux 6.16-RC5 was just released by Linus Torvalds, and while it might seem like just another release candidate, there are some important fixes in here. The big story is a performance regression fix in the Futex code. The kernel team had to disable a new feature called Futex Private Hash for the 6.16 cycle because it was causing some serious scheduler performance issues. Don't worry though, they're planning to properly fix this for Linux 6.17, so we'll get the performance benefits without the regression. Also seeing new hardware support landing, including Intel Wildcat Lake HID support and various x86 platform driver additions. Plus, there's support for the Acer Nitro Gaming Controller NGR200. Great news for Linux gamers who want to use this specific controller. Now, here's where things get interesting and a bit concerning. We're seeing Bcachefs fixes merged into 6.16-RC5, but there's been ongoing drama around this file system. Linus Torvalds has hinted that Bcachefs might get dropped from the kernel entirely. There have been development disputes, and frankly, the future of this next-generation file system is looking uncertain. Linux 6.16 stable should be out by the end of July or early August, depending on whether they need an extra release candidate. And speaking of stable releases, we're also seeing the usual LTS updates. 6.15.5, 6.12.36 LTS, 6.6.96 LTS, and 6.1.143 LTS all got updates this week. Oh, and here's something that might affect some of you retro computing enthusiasts. As of Linux 6.15, the kernel no longer supports 80486 processors or early 586 chips. So if you've been running modern Linux on that vintage hardware, 6.14 might be your last stop. Speaking of 6.15, Arch Linux just released their July 2025 ISO, version 2025.07.01, and it's the first Arch ISO to ship with Linux kernel 6.15. If you're doing fresh Arch installations, you're getting all the latest kernel goodness right out of the box. Let's talk distributions, because we've had some interesting releases this week. The standout is definitely Rhino Linux 2025.3, and this one's got some significant changes that I think you'll find interesting. Rhino Linux has switched to using the RPK2 package management tool by default. For those not familiar, RPK2 is their custom package manager that's designed to work with their rolling release model. They've also added a KDE Plasma 6 UBXI desktop option, which is pretty exciting if you're a KDE fan. But here's the really cool part. Rhino Linux is now officially sponsored by the UBports Foundation. For those who don't know, UBports is the organization behind Ubuntu Touch, the mobile Linux distribution. This sponsorship should provide Rhino with more stability and resources for development. We also got MellowE Linux 2025.07.04, which now ships with the Xanmod kernel by default. Xanmod is a performance-focused kernel that includes various patches for better desktop responsiveness and gaming performance. If you're looking for a distribution that prioritizes performance out of the box, this might be worth checking out. Gentoo users got some love too, with updated install media based on KDE Plasma 6.3. The 2025-06-29 images are available now, so if you're brave enough to tackle a Gentoo installation, you'll have the latest desktop environment to work with. And speaking of hardware, Tuxedo released their OS 2025-07-02 update. Tuxedo OS is specifically designed for Tuxedo hardware, and they've been doing some really interesting work in the Linux laptop space. We also saw releases from EasyOS 6.101, Barry Linux 1.42, CentOS Stream 10-2025-06-30, and 4mil Linux 48.1. The Linux distribution ecosystem continues to be incredibly diverse and active. Now, here's something Ubuntu users need to be aware of. Ubuntu 24.10 is nearing its end of life. If you're still running 24.10, you should start planning your upgrade to a newer version. The Ubuntu team typically provides about 9 months of support for non-LTS releases, so this isn't unexpected, but it's something to keep on your radar. Debian users got some good news with the Debian 13 installer RC2 becoming available. One of the cool new features is support for rescuing BTRFS systems that were installed via the Calamares installer. This is a nice quality of life improvement for users who prefer BTRFS as their file system. Let's dive into desktop environments, and KDE users are getting some nice treats this week. KDE Plasma 6.4.2 just dropped, and while it's a point release, there are some solid improvements in here. The big improvement is to the Kicker app menu widget. If you're using the traditional application launcher, you'll notice better performance and some bug fixes that make the experience smoother. They've also improved Spectacle, KDE's screenshot tool, with better functionality and stability. We also got KDE Gear 25.04.3, which is the final update in the 25.04 series. This includes updates to all the KDE applications like Dolphin, Kate, Console, and many others. It's always nice to see the KDE team maintaining their software with regular updates. Now, let's talk about a major update that's going to affect a lot of Linux users, Thunderbird 140 ESR. This is a significant release because it's focused on enterprise needs, but it has features that benefit everyone. The standout new features are mark as spam and mark as starred actions directly in notifications. This might seem like a small thing, but when you're dealing with a lot of email, being able to triage messages without opening the main application is a huge productivity boost. But here's the absolute game changer for Linux gaming. Steam has enabled Proton by default for games without native Linux builds. But let me repeat that because it's huge. Proton is now the default for non-native games on Steam for Linux. This means that when you install a Windows game on Steam for Linux, it will automatically use Proton to run it. No more manually enabling Proton for each game. No more digging through compatibility settings. This is going to make Linux gaming so much more accessible for newcomers. The implications of this change are massive. We're talking about thousands of Windows games that will now just work on Linux out of the box. This could be the tipping point that finally makes Linux a viable gaming platform for mainstream users. Photography enthusiasts got some love with Digicam 8.7, which includes a new auto-rotation tool based on content analysis. This is pretty sophisticated. Instead of just reading EXIF data, it actually analyzes the image content to determine the correct orientation. Developers using Gini got version 2.1, which brings a smoother UI, new file type support, and improved theming. Gini is one of those lightweight IDEs that's perfect for quick edits and smaller projects, so these improvements are welcome. Gaming got another boost with DXVK 2.7, which improves support for God of War, Watch Dogs 2, and Final Fantasy XIV. DXVK is the DirectX to Vulkan translation layer that makes many Windows games playable on Linux, so performance improvements here directly benefit Linux gamers. System administrators and power users will appreciate Bash 5.3, which includes new command substitution features. Bash is the default shell on most Linux distributions, so improvements here affect virtually everyone in the Linux ecosystem. We also got 7-Zip V25 with performance improvements. File compression and decompression might not be the most exciting topic, but when you're dealing with large archives regularly, these performance gains add up. Let's talk hardware, because there's some exciting news for Linux laptop enthusiasts. Tuxedo just announced that their Stellaris 16 Gen 7 laptop now ships with AMD Ryzen 9 CPUs. Tuxedo has been doing incredible work in the Linux laptop space, and their machines come with Linux pre-installed and fully supported. The Ryzen 9 CPUs in these laptops are absolute powerhouses. We're talking about processors that can handle serious workloads, video editing, 3D rendering, software development, you name it. And the fact that it's all running Linux natively with full hardware support is just beautiful. NVIDIA users got the 575.64.03 driver release this week. While NVIDIA's relationship with the Linux community has been complicated over the years, they have been more consistent with their driver releases lately. This update includes the usual bug fixes and performance improvements. Open source graphics got some love too, with Mesa 25.1.5. Mesa is the open source graphics stack that powers AMD and Intel graphics on Linux, and it's been getting some impressive performance improvements lately. The gap between open source and proprietary drivers continues to shrink. One of the things I love about the current state of Linux hardware support is how much has improved over the years. We're seeing day one support for new hardware, manufacturers like Tuxedo and System 76 building Linux-first machines, and even traditional laptop manufacturers starting to offer Linux options. The framework laptop ecosystem continues to grow, and their modular approach combined with excellent Linux support is really changing the game. Being able to upgrade and repair your laptop while running Linux natively is something we could only dream about a few years ago. Let's talk about some community developments that are going to make life easier for Linux users and self-hosters. Let's Encrypt now supports IP address certificates. This is huge for anyone running services on their home network or managing internal infrastructure. Previously, if you wanted HTTPS for a service running on a local IP address, you had to jump through hoops with DNS or use self-signed certificates. Now you can get a proper Let's Encrypt certificate for your IP address, which makes securing internal services so much easier. Cosmic Desktop Environment has landed in Void Linux. Cosmic is System76's new desktop environment written in Rust, and it's been generating a lot of excitement in the Linux community. Having it available in Void Linux means more people can test it and provide feedback. Fedora made an interesting decision this week. They're holding off on dropping i686 support, citing community needs. This is a great example of how Linux distributions listen to their users. While 32-bit x86 is definitely legacy at this point, there are still use cases where it's needed. The Copyleft Next license relaunched with new backing and a renewed mission. For those interested in open source licensing, this is an attempt to create a more modern copyleft license that addresses some of the complexities of current licenses like the GPL. OpenSUSE Tumbleweed users got an interesting update with the introduction of Merlin. This is part of OpenSUSE's ongoing efforts to improve their rolling release distribution, and it shows how active development continues across the entire Linux ecosystem. Alpine Linux developers are working on something called Wayback as an experimental X-compatibility layer. This could be interesting for users who want to run legacy X11 applications on Wayland systems. It's still experimental, but it shows the kind of innovation happening in the Linux space. What a week it's been in Linux land! We've covered critical security vulnerabilities that you need to patch immediately, exciting kernel developments, major distribution releases, desktop environment improvements, and some game-changing updates for Linux gaming. But seriously, if you take one thing away from this video, make sure you update your Sudo package. Those vulnerabilities are no joke, and the fixes are available now. If this weekly roundup helped you stay on top of the Linux world, please hit that like button and subscribe to Ton Does Linux and More. I put out Linux content every week, covering everything from news like this to tutorials, reviews, and deep dives into specific topics. What was your favorite Linux news story this week? Are you excited about Proton being enabled by default in Steam? Let me know in the comments below. I read every single one and love hearing from the community. Thanks for watching. Keep exploring Linux, and I'll see you in the next video.